The reason why I would like to remain anonymous is because I found that the more I've spoken out about the Children's Aid Society, the more they've gone and made a very concerted effort to make my life more difficult and create problems between myself and my children. So if it means silencing you somehow by using your child as a pawn.
Well, if they've already lost their kid, they really have nothing further to lose. They should be speaking out. It's the people who have their kids that should be very careful.
I know I'm not alone in everything that's happened to me, but I want people to know that SAS has actually destroyed my family and didn't help my family at all. They tore it completely apart, and it's not going to ever be back together again. And I blame them.
I cannot tell you the anger, the rage that I have, because I know that other children are in foster care, they're getting abused. Some of them die.
It's terrible. I don't know what our words say. We call them Jayawish. That means the devil work is what they're doing.
Every opportunity I have to tell people this story, especially in the Jewish community, because people don't know that this is going on. They don't, people find it so hard to believe that a Children's Aid Society could act maliciously. It just goes outside of what people believe, but it's true. It's 100% true.
I want to tell this story because mine isn't the only horror story out there. And if this can get people into action, then it's worth it. No other child needs to suffer. It's not the way to live.
And that's what's so beautiful about our system, because it's collaborative. We sit the parents down. What a concept! What do you need to become a better parent? Not, I'm sitting out here at my little desk and I've decided that you have to take a parenting course, or you have to take anger management, or you have to go through an alcohol treatment program.
You know, I worked at various agencies in the city, and I saw families broken, just completely broken. Families that had given up, families that no longer even visited their children because they were so discouraged with kind of hoops that they had to jump through in order to have access with their children.
The mandates of Anishinaabeyaski Legal Services is law reform, and one of the areas of law reform that we're dealing with is the child welfare issue. So we have created an alternative dispute resolution model based on traditional Aboriginal methods called talking together.
Welcome. Before we start, we need to establish some rules. In our circle, respect, openness, and fairness are important. We all sit at the same level to remind us that we are not here to pass judgment, but to restore harmony in our relationships.
Our circle process takes cases that are involved with child welfare, and it can be anywhere along the continuum. It can be as soon as the family becomes involved, it can be preventative, it can be when they're on the doorsteps of the courthouse. And the idea is to bring all of the interested parties together in a circle to do some brainstorming about what the possible solutions are on a grander scale than just the immediate family. Like, we bring in community members, extended family, caregivers, people who can help with particular problems that have been identified, elders, clergy. It's a huge, the possibilities are endless, and it might probably is the first time that all these people are in a room together.
Where we're learning together as a team, doing this job that's really important. It's our future.
A solution emerges, which is something that can help the children stay connected with their families, their communities, and their culture. The circle, I like to say it's magic. And why not let this magic work for children? Because it's just so much more humane.
Thank you. Children's aid societies in Ontario have enormous powers. They have powers of search and seizure. They have powers of taking your child and interviewing your child alone without you being present, without a teacher being present. They have the powers to apprehend your child, take your child away, and put your child in a foster home. It's very, very significant. There are no other government agencies that have those types of powers.
The potential for abuse is enormous because of the way the thing is set up. I mean, what protection do people have other than hiring expensive lawyers?
My daughter was really, really having a rough time. So in March of 7 years ago, she phoned, "Mom, I can't do it anymore. I can't handle it. Could you keep my kids?" And I took her four children in.
In 2003, I had a very bad drug problem with cocaine, and my son was apprehended. At the time, he went to a group home, and he was bounced around from several foster homes, probably four or five different foster homes.
The big picture came in, said Delique will pay you. Well, that made it okay for me. I didn't realize what I was getting myself in.
My mom, she tried to kill us twice. I wish she did, you know? She tried to drown us, and then she tried to drown us in the lake. Me, especially. Yeah, I wish she would have.
This kind of thing means that there's a role, clearly a role, for child protection.
How can someone not want their kids? You know,
in my heart, I knew I couldn't be a good mother. And that's why I reached out to them, you know? I went to this place called, it was in Etobicoke, called Teens Against Crack and Cocaine. And I went to her and I told her I had a problem. I'll never forget, you know, I had my, and she'd never forget either. I had my, there was my little son, a little three-year-old boy.
One of the teachers were going by. I tapped her lightly on the shoulder, and the police came and see me and said I was charged with assault. And all it was just a tap on her arm. I didn't literally do nothing with her. I had no intentions of harming her. I didn't have none whatsoever. And that's how they took my kids away. My grandkids away.
They were smiling. And I thought, how can you be smiling when you're coming to take literally someone's child out of their arms? I was holding my young child when they came in and took the baby right from me. Barely enough time to say goodbye, nothing, no explanation.
We had a maid service in Orangeville, had a large home that was too big for us to clean by ourselves. So the maid service came in every 2 weeks. The maid service consisted of the person who owned the franchise, who came every time, and a helper. And the helper changed every few weeks or every few months, depending on how long she stuck around. Well, one day a helper came in for the first time, and she reported that when she got to the home, it really needed a cleanup, which was absolutely true, because I don't throw my money away on maids to clean a home that does not need a cleanup. Well, she got in touch with Children's Aid, and Children's Aid came around, and they came in with two cops, walked off with our son.
I don't know why they came to the school. I don't know why I got sent down to the office.
No, they just said that I would be notified and that I would have a court date within 5 days. We have concerns. That was the extent of it.
And there's four adults asking me questions about my home life, railroading me with, it's not safe, you're in danger, we're here to help you, your mom can't protect you. So by the end of it, no matter how determined you are that it is safe, your mom is your mama bear, you come out thinking, well, no, it's not safe. There's four adults, one child. My mom, I said, well, I want my mom there. Well, we're not going to call her. So I was taken from my school into the CAS offices, and they placed me in a foster home that night. Didn't even get to say goodbye. It was just, here, you're there, and now you're in.
Like, you know, and I've had kids come to me and say, like this one boy with CP especially, he said, I've been kidnapped. And I said, you know what, you're right. You have been.
We had Ava with us for about 5 months, and unbeknownst to us, after about the first month that Ava was at our house, the grandmother changed her mind and decided that she didn't want to put Ava up for adoption. And Children's Aid neglected to tell us that information for the next 4 months.
They don't want you to know the truth. And I guess they're good at hiding it.
And in our experience with Children's Aid, what we found is confidential is actually code for secret. We'd like to keep it a secret. It's not so much as it's confidential, it's we don't want you to know it, and we're going to keep it secret. You know.
They always claim that the confidentiality rules are to benefit the child. Nothing of the sort is happening. Those confidentiality rules are they're purely to protect the agency. In cases where it's to their advantage to discuss a case in public, they do, and they use real names.
They decided that I had Munchausen by proxy. It's an illness where you harm people that you supposedly care about. And then when they get better, you're seen as the heroine. They said I was too involved with my children and their illnesses. I fought that because I said, look, what do you want me to do? Go to the ADHD doctor every week and say, now what is ADHD? Or do I build on it over the years?
Judges would tell me that, you know, I wasn't an adequate mother, and I didn't know how to parent a child with ADHD, which I had done up until the apprehension.
When Dylan's turn was up at Kinark, the residential program, and he was to be returned to me, they phoned CAS and said there's no way they're going to release him to my custody. They would only release him to CAS custody.
My case was dismissed by a judge who felt that even though I had 5 years sobriety and a home and that I was his mother and that I loved him, the judge felt that I had no experience with such a child.
I assume that there's some minimal standards that society would accept as best interest. So sort of roof over a child's head, food on the table on a daily basis, make sure that they attend school as a minimum standard, we would expect that parents could at least do that. So I think when we're advocating on behalf of parents, it may seem trivial for us to determine, oh, you know, roof over the head, food on the table, but it's not. We take it for granted, or a lot of us take it for granted, that that's something that parents should be able to provide. But we shouldn't take it for granted, because for some people that is a daily battle.
You know, there's so many kids up north that don't even have homes. There's tar paper shacks up there.
They made me move from my rental apartment. I had a townhouse, it was rent controlled. And in order for Callie to come back from the first time she was in care, I couldn't live there. Because that was the home where father lived with us and abuse had happened, and they didn't want Callie stuck in the memories. So my rent went from very low to almost $1,000 a month that I'm on ODSP. So I had to take grocery money to pay the rent because they would not return Callie to me if I lived in that unit.
They primarily target the people who are least likely to defend themselves. Their favorite target, over half of all cases, is the single mother. Single mothers typically have no resources to fight back. They have just enough to pay their bills, nothing else, when their child is taken away.
I think we live in a very complicated society where people who have financial resources are able to mask deficiencies in their parenting.
Take a typical mother that has two children, or even one child, and they're on social assistance. Well, that typical person may get approximately $1,100 a month and possibly some child tax credit money, which may bring them up to $1,200 or $1,300 a month. And say someone makes a call, Children's Aid goes over, sees that there's not enough food in the house, sees that the house may be in disarray and probably not necessarily up to the standards of our average person. Well, we think that it's best, or that there might be a risk of harm to the child, so that child is removed. So the child is removed. Well, once that child is removed, that mother's source of income is removed, because then the welfare drops to a single person rate of $520 a month.
Your child support, your child tax benefit, it's all gone. It goes to them.
And now the mother isn't able to meet her minimum obligations to maintain the residence that she has or the food that she requires.
It was that black and white. And then they had Callie return to my care on the 2nd of the month. If anybody knows about ODSP, you get paid the last day of the month. So I couldn't get Callie on my budget till the end of the next month. And they would not offer any assistance whatsoever in helping me feed her. You either get it together and she comes home, or she doesn't.
Some people have a belief that, well, if the Children's Aid Society will help. And in theory, it should.
When your child isn't in their care, they don't care.
Never once, and I probably don't do it today with other people, did they say, can we help you? Do you need help? Never, never, never did they.
My grandkids were suffering big time. They're having to deal with the loss of mom, the loss of a dad, loss of their home, loss of the baby, and my granddaughter was being sexually abused. Nothing was taken care of. I tried really hard the first year to try and seek help for these kids.
You know, they barely even care for anybody's kids, even kids they take. They don't care. It's so blatantly obvious, and then the public and out there in society, most people don't care until it happens to them. And it can happen to anyone, right?
And we all have a stake in this because, I mean, as a society, we're as strong as our weakest link, really.
I would assume that an average foster parent gets $30 per day per child, which means that they would get approximately $900 a month for a child.
Well, why not pay the poor mother that money so she can get the money and can get the food and whatever is missing.
I am his mother. That's what makes me greater than anybody. I gave birth to him. I love him unconditionally. I am never going to give him back. I will give him unconditional love and guidance and help him mature and grow. He can't have those things in a group home. He's looked after by a staff. He can't have someone give him a hug and say, I love you, you've done a great job at school today, because they don't love him.
So we have, in essence, where our society is willing to pay someone that's not a parent to a child more than they are willing to give to a parent of a child. And I mean, I personally have a bit of an issue with that, because it doesn't seem to make sense. I think society, if we want to help people, we should be focusing on helping them and using the resources to help them.
Daniel had very complex, multiple neurological issues, and it was hard to find a program that worked for him. We had no problem with him at home. Of course, he'd have like temper tantrums, but we didn't have a problem with him at home. Like, we knew what worked. And what happened with these foster parents and the agency was the agency, like, didn't want to deal with it.
They introduced Ava to us as mommy and daddy. They said, you know, here, this is it.
If these parents get emotional, compassionate, it's their child. They're supposed to be like that. The agency is supposed to remain professional, and they didn't. They became malicious, and in a horrifyingly traumatic event, they just ripped this child out of his foster home.
I spent 4 years working with Daniel as his respite worker. Daniel bonded with his foster family. It is a loving home, and he made amazing progress. This warm, happy, loving, secure environment was utterly destroyed when Jewish Family and Child Service and went in and seized him. I fear his seizure is entirely unethical, and subsequently I felt morally obligated to quit my job at Jewish Family and Child Service.
It was absolutely devastating. I mean, I couldn't sleep, I couldn't eat.
I didn't do nothing. I didn't know nothing for about 2 days. I was just stunned. I didn't know what to do.
Nobody can really understand what it feels like to have your children taken away until you have your children taken away, I would think. And then they say, oh, she was angry and had an anger management problem. And, well, you know, you would say, I congratulate this mother for the ability to restrain herself, because having your children taken away must be one of the most horrible situations that anybody ever incurs, much worse than physical illness or something like that.
You're not allowed to see the child, and you don't know how that child's doing. All communication is cut off. You've got to hire a lawyer to see your child. You have to deal with social workers who are antagonistic, who are inflexible, who are rigid, who are holding all the cards.
It's not a job that normal people can do. How many people can go into a home that is pretty much a home like anybody else and take the children away from mom and dad? Very few people can do it. It's something that only certain special people can do.
Apprehension of children should be a last resort after everything else has failed. But too often it's the first resort.
It took a whole year before I finally went to court, and only to find out that teacher I assaulted didn't even have nobody there for her. And not only that, the arm I touched and the injury was on the opposite side.
It was a really sad experience. It took us 16 days to get our kid back, and it took us eight months to get Children's Aid completely out of our life. We managed to get the case dismissed by a judge.
I think once you look at parental neglect as a legal issue, then everybody starts looking at it in a way that has little to do with parenting and a lot to do with gathering evidence in order to prove something, whether proving I'm a fit mother or proving you're an unfit person or proving abuse or not proving abuse. And as a result, everyone becomes a private investigator.
The Children's Aid started to realize that I had been recording for an awfully long time. And I'd been recording everything from telephone conversations to court appearances to supervised access visits.
When a case goes to court, you have on the one side the Children's Aid Society, who has an inexhaustible source of legal representation, of support staff, and usually money.
And it is kind of like, you know, you've got all these lawyers on this side and me sitting here, it is kind of like the world against you.
Again, I don't have a lawyer. The legal comes with their big fancy lawyer, their workers.
You just assume that a lawyer is going to have their client's best interest at heart.
The first lawyer I had was an idiot.
By the time I had what I thought was competent counsel, it was the counsel that told me to just give them their crown wardship.
That's pretty much saying you're going to have your parental rights terminated forever. And although there is ways for a crown wardship to be reversed,
it's very rare that that happens, and it's not an easy process.
It's very easy for a society social worker to simply tell a parent, see you in court. But the social workers don't give the parents legal advice. They don't tell them what they're supposed to do or how they're supposed to do it.
They have essentially only their own experience to go on. They don't have the kind of resources that we're talking about, man.
It's very unfair, and there's an imbalance of power that's quite substantial.
When you are dealing with legal aid, you're dealing, you know, you don't have expensive counsel.
And that is not a good feeling, because I figure if you had enough money behind you and a damn good lawyer, they wouldn't get away with all this crap.
Absolutely. There was one occasion at one of the hearings when I was sitting in the waiting room by myself, and my son's lawyer got off the elevator and immediately, from the entire waiting room to hear, said in her loudest of voices, "Your son does not want to come home. He doesn't want to see you. Let's just bring this to a close today. This is a complete waste of time."
It's habitual for children's aid to tell the child, "Your mom and dad don't want you anymore." And they also tell mom and dad, "Your child doesn't want you anymore." And both of these are false. But as long as the child and the parents cannot communicate with each other, neither one knows that it's false.
He's got to wonder why he's not here with me. I mean, I know how I think and how I feel, so I can't imagine how a 12-year-old feels. I just hope he doesn't feel like I've let him down or that I haven't tried. And I don't know what he's been told, so without access to him, I really don't know.
I'm not completely happy with the whole concept of the Office of the Children of Law. It all sounds very good, right?
Unfortunately, in my opinion, unfortunately, the Office of the Children's Lawyer believes as a policy, at least to date, and you know, maybe that might be reviewed, that a lawyer can intervene in a way so as to make submissions to a judge that are different than what the client wants, based on the perception that the lawyer has about what's in the best interest of the child. In my humble opinion, that is misguided, because the judge is there to decide what's in the best interest of the child.
We have been trying to use the court system to deal with the best interests of children, and it hasn't been working. It has been causing all kinds of disconnect, all kinds of grief, people losing their families, children losing that connection to their parents and their extended families.
Because the best interest of the child is subject to all kinds of interpretation. It's often used to deprive children of their fundamental rights. 5 stinking years, all those attachments were broken. And they just wouldn't admit that they did something wrong.
Yeah, and I had to really struggle when I came back to form an attachment with my mom again.
It took a long time.
So often, from the time a child is apprehended to the time a final disposition is made, takes months, sometimes years. That's the tragedy, because what happens to a child who is in the system is not very pleasant.
Yeah, CIS decided that the guy who abused me was deserved, I think would be the right word, visitation with his kids. When I was 8, I remember thinking, he hurt me. My mom never hurt me. Why do you want to see me?
I think the sad truth is oftentimes a child is being abused and the mother is reporting it, and the level of proof that they're required to give is high.
He leads me into the laundry room, locks the door, throws me down. I scream for somebody to help me. Nobody does. The next thing I remember is waking up, naked, crying, banging on the laundry room door.
I can't believe people are like that, man, especially towards kids. You know, I couldn't fathom doing it to my kids. It's like, fuck, I'd rather be dead.
It took me a couple weeks to tell my mom what happened. And my mom got on the phone with the CAS caseworker, told her, and said, there's nothing we can do. He's got access. So what? You can't, you didn't protect me. You're supposed to.
And then what did I do?
Mom took me to the cops.
Yes.
And took me to the cops, went up to the front desk, told them what happened. We were waiting for less than 15 minutes before the head of sex crimes against children came down. She interviewed me, came back, told my mom there's no doubt. He did what he did. He did what he did, and we've put him in the sex offender registry. And she turned to me and she gave me these bead things and said, whenever you remember what happened.
Hold the beads and know that it wasn't your fault. Know that you didn't deserve what happened to you. And know that somebody's got your back.
I have people say, well, don't people sometimes invent being abused? Perhaps it's happened. In the hundreds of people that I've represented, I've had my doubts about maybe one or two. I just don't think it's the kind of thing that people invent. I just don't believe that to be the case, you know.
The foster home for many months with my school schedule, Dad and I had visits twice a week, Mondays and Wednesdays. The one Monday, we got a call saying the visit was canceled because the little one had a cold. And we thought, that's fine, kids get colds, right? So we go on Wednesday, and I said, oh, sweets, I missed you on Monday, you were sick. And baby said, I know, sick. And an hour later, Dad's rolling around on the floor playing with baby. There's 8 visible bruises on his back, between his neck to his waist, side to side.
First time there, I fall down the stairs, land on my left wrist on her portable barbecues. She had 2 portable barbecues. I land smack on them. I'm crying and screaming. She opens the door, goes, what the fuck are you, what the fuck are you crying about? I fell. No, you didn't. Get back up these stairs and go to bed.
I called for 5 days relentlessly to Children's Aid, trying to get somebody on the phone who could give me some sort of an explanation. And it wasn't until the following Monday. The report was that he didn't need to go to a doctor. It was nothing. He had slipped in the bathtub. I said 8 times. The Wednesday when we noticed these bruises, they were green and yellow in color. So the reason why you didn't send him on Monday is because he was probably still black and blue. How does a small child get 8 individual bruises, different areas of the back, from a single slip in a bathtub?
There were 2 bedrooms. Hers was always locked. She had locks on the top of the doors, so she could lock us in our rooms if she chose to. Which CAS knew, because every visit they checked to see if they were intact.
And I've seen them close homes where they themselves put in alarm systems on the bedrooms and use that as an excuse to close that foster home down.
I quickly learned my place in the house. I was mom. 13 years old, becoming 30, I did the cleaning of the house, top to bottom, vacuuming the stairs. I did the laundry. I cooked the meals. I ran the dishwasher. I even did the girls' baths. Ran the girls' baths for the 7 and 8 year old.
When I got this one little girl, they wanted me to put bars in the window. I said, are you out of your mind? Well, they said, there's a history here. I says, no one is putting bars in her bedroom window.
Well, they kept us in the basement. Like days upon days, they just chucked the food down and they put us down saying we're no good for nothing. It was white people. I have no offense towards you, but like some people are really evil, you know?
She would even get mad if the girls spilt a glass of milk. So I was always on edge, quick to say, I did it. So I got the hit, I got the smack, I got beat instead of them.
She lived with a guy named, her son named Leon, he was little there. And he crawled in, thought he crawled inside the bed with us, or with me, I mean. And then he started fooling around with me, and he said it was okay for me to suck his pecker, you know? And he did that night after night, night after night, night after night, you know? And he goes, don't tell anybody or I'll kill you, or I'll kill your sister, eh, my twin sister?
I tried, and I could not physically raise my arms above my head because of all the bruises and markings I had on my back. I couldn't do it.
And then we went to this place called the Charlie's. Fuck, the shit that happened there, man. You know what? I can't talk about that part, what happened there. It was just back there. I'll tell you one thing, man. Like, they stripped us naked, and they made us hold our hands up in the air for 6 hours while they made fun of us. Then they tried to make me and my sister have sex.
Abusers, especially sexual predators, tend to identify the most vulnerable, the most damaged children, and choose them as targets.
My worker comes by, talks to me, then goes down to talk to her. And she's crying and saying, I don't know why she's saying all this stuff. I don't know why she's against me. Crying and putting up, what does my worker say? I know, it's a shame. It's a shame she sees you like that. What? My worker siding with her. I've got marks on my back. I have marks on my arms and my legs. But it's my fault? Okay.
They didn't care, and then when I was 14, I told them everything. They didn't care. Sure, they did an investigation, you know, but people denied it and they closed it.
I was so depressed that night, I decided I was gonna end my life.
You know, today I've always had a problem with suicide, and it's always there, you know.
We called the local police force. I explained the situation, where we were, that it was a supervised access visit, that the child was in care.
I would certainly expect that our police today respond with much more vigor and enthusiasm than they used to.
They said, we're sorry, we can't help you. If you have child protection concerns, you have to call Family and Children Services. I said, are you hearing what I'm saying to you? Powerless. They're as powerless as a parent is.
Well, they lied to the child. His social worker told him he wouldn't go into a group home. She told him they'd never put him into a group home. He's in a group home.
So guess what? I turn this home, it's like daycare. I turn this home and I have 9 kids living here. I fly under that radar. It's privately, so you imagine, I can only imagine, what money is involved in running a home with nine teenagers, or 9 children, I shouldn't say teenagers, nine children.
We are making money at the organization. That when we lose a client, because we've lost this client several times, in the last year, we don't get as much money coming in if he's in jail, if he gets moved to another care home. And because it's a new home, we may not get another client right away. It comes down to money. So less incident reports mean less going to the worker, less, you know.
Once they get into the foster care system, and particularly in the group home settings, of being sent off to psychiatrists who diagnose a variety of exotic disorders and put these children, some as young as 6 years old, on a cocktail of very strong drugs, some of which are described as neuroleptics, which were originally defined as lobotomy in a bottle, and have not been authorized for use in individuals under 18. And yet, in some of the group homes that I had access to, I found that almost every single child was on a neuroleptic as well as other drugs.
Again, these are controls, and it's more about making these kids docile and thing instead of making them functional members of society.
So the whole situation is just shameful. It's dangerous. It's ongoing because there's a lot of profit in it. And it's all done under children's mental health, which I've come to believe is just a sham, and if anyone asks me, I suggest that they find somewhere else to donate their time, energies, or money than to children's mental health, because the state that it's in at present is just giving money to what I consider to be professional child predators, child drug pushers.
If we're going to bring these children into care, you need to look at research that shows that bringing children into care and keeping them in care, that when they come out of that system, that they're actually doing better than if they would have been left in their family homes. I think that research is missing. And I think that's really important research that needs to be done, because you need to have something better for children if you're going to take them out of their family homes.
They kept on telling me, you're a foster parent, not a grandmother anymore. I don't know what the difference is with Rico. My grandkids still call me Gran.
You're not wanted as a parent. You know what you are? You're a holding facility is what you are, okay? That's what basically they even told me that. You're a holding facility, you're not a parent.
The terminology itself, foster parent, implies that you're acting in the role of a parent. And I would assume that because you're acting in the role of a parent, that you're there to show that this child, that you're committed to them, that you love them, that someone loves them, and that someone cares about them. And I think that goes a lot further than telling them, or at least not showing them that commitment or that love or that affection. If that's an environment that they came from, then what would be the purpose of putting them back in the same environment?
Whatever they told me to do, I did. Take a parent and go, sure, no problem. Do this, no problem. Take this, talk to this person, do this assessment, do that. And they just never to let you go home.
Every time I thought I was a little bit closer to the society being a little bit fair, something would happen, or they would make a promise to me and take it away.
That's how it normally went. No direct communication. Everything changed all the time. You couldn't put a sure foot down anywhere, because they changed the rules. They changed what they wanted. And I was just trying to do everything I could to do what they wanted so they could get my kids back.
For the first 3 years, it was a struggle. I was called on so many times by other people and reported by other people that I was mistreating the kids just by raising my voice. I am a loud person. I don't have a soft voice.
There are all kinds of circumstances where parents can be said to be abusive. That doesn't mean that they're abusive all the time. There's all kinds of parents who, in spite of living in very chaotic households with very little money, are remarkable in what they do for their children. And to me, should be given a medal for raising three kids a lot of times on their own with very little financial and emotional resources, instead of applauding the 360 days where they did well. We kind of start blaming them for having done something on that two or three other days where, for whatever reason, they fell below the standard in terms of their parenting.
If I made one mistake of anything, you know, the leak was down on my back, steady.
I have the worker on the phone yelling at me, "If you ever cry in front of any one of your children again, you will have supervised access in this building exclusively. Is that crystal clear?" I'm going, "I'm not allowed to cry. I'm not allowed to do this. I'm not allowed to do." It was just always like that. Here's your ultimatum. You do what we say or this ultimatum. Or you're not going to get this. Or you're not going to get that.
Yeah.
Always, 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 always.
They are very boastful of the power they have to destroy families. I had one woman told me she was in a meeting with a social worker, and the social worker boasted, "We have as much power as God." And I'm afraid to say she was not, it was not much of an exaggeration.
In child welfare, you actually have more power than the police, because you can actually take people's children from them, and that's like pretty much the ultimate power that people have.
Well, there's no doubt. I mean, there's an imbalance of power from the word go. I mean, you know, the Children's Aid Society has an enormous power under the legislation.
Some people get high doing this.
No one wants to see kids suffer. No one wants to see kids hurt. No one wants certainly to see kids dying. But in the process, though, we can be subjecting a lot of other children to systemic abuse, bureaucratic abuse, as a result, in the name of helping them.
People have power, and they have a mandate, and they misuse it, or either because they want to, but mostly I think it's ineptness.
And they look at the, you know, a kind of a risk assessment model, and they try to figure out what the level of risk is by looking at different behaviors and doing a check mark, and instead of sort of opening their eyes and understanding what's going on and put it in the context of this family, and exercise some good old-fashioned professionalism.
There's a tendency on the part of the society to try to win the case. And by winning the case, I mean to try to justify its position. Not necessarily shine a light on what's fair or just or reasonable, but to try to win their case.
Well, it's a pretty cynical theory. I don't think that winning is the objective. I think that that's grossly unfair to the Children's Aid Society.
Now, I know that's a strong statement to make, but I've seen it too many times where social workers have suppressed evidence that we find out later on by reviewing their notes, or they failed to interview an important witness, or they've interviewed the child, changed what the child has said, left things out that the child has said that might help to exonerate the parents. These are very serious allegations, but they're done, and you've got to test them. So from a very early stage, you want to cross-examine the social worker.
I mean, I've seen it myself. A worker, you know, or an affidavit being questioned, they've been caught lying in court. If an average citizen did that, there would be serious consequences for perjuring themselves. There's none. It's almost as if they're allowed. Oh, well, they made a mistake. It gets, you know, it gets fluffed off like it's nothing. Well, no, it's not nothing.
Cross-examination to a social worker is like garlic to a vampire. They hate it. They do not want to be cross-examined because they can't hide behind what they've put in their affidavit.
You can't just say, you know, these people lie and these people take the children away and this is when they are, when they're called baby abductors and all of this. It's really not, it's not...
Baby snatching? Well, they have to pick up a certain number of babies to justify their existence, or children, I should say. They don't all have to be babies. When they need someone, they, you know, when they need more kids, they will target some people and find a reason for taking away the kids. At least find reasons that that they can put down in documents as the reason for taking them. Those things that they write down in court papers are very rarely the real reason for taking the kids. The real reason is budgetary. If they have a certain budget for child protection, they have to have enough children to justify that budget.
The staff members never bear any of the consequences of what they inflict on the children and the family. They never bear any consequences, you know, and it's a travesty. And that's why they continue to conduct themselves the way they do.
One thing to control that would be to eliminate the legal immunity for social workers.
And we need registered social workers only.
The frontline staff are largely not registered with the college.
Anyone who represents themselves as a social worker in the province of Ontario or a social service worker has to be registered with the college. And if they're not doing that, if that doesn't happen, they are outside of the act. In other words, they're conducting themselves against the law.
The college had either taken cautionary or disciplinary action on a total of 8% of the complaints that it received in that prior four-year period. So once I realized that they didn't seem to actually be that active, we just left it.
I don't think anybody that's not qualified and is not going to be ethical and moral in all of their practice should be at all dealing with a family on the forefront. It's not appropriate. And in my opinion, it's downright criminal.
I've seen social workers, and I gotta tell you which town or where it was, actually sitting at her kitchen table crying, because she didn't know if she could do this job one more day. Because she was forced to ask questions that she felt were none of her business or anyone else's. And she didn't think she could do that job anymore. So you know what? It's not the social worker that's your enemy sometimes. It's the system that exists that puts in policies and procedures that are unacceptable to humans.
And the problem with the culture is that the society is often, if not always, more concerned with how it's going to look than it is with doing right by the family.
That's an abuse of power. They get all this money from the government from donations, and they're using it to protect themselves, not the children. Also, what's going on is this hearing, and as far as I understand it, it's just being dragged out and dragged out and dragged out and dragged out to bankrupt the family.
The province spends tens of millions of dollars every year on legal fees to deal with issues that if we had better social services could improve immensely.
So when I see something in the newspaper along the lines that the society is running out of money, it's a bit galling for me to see that when I know that the society devotes an enormous amount of money and resources to litigating these cases instead of helping parents at the outset.
And reduce the number of cases that actually go to court. And use the money, instead of paying lawyers like me to go fight, use the money to help the family.
But who needs money when you could have love?
If I had $50 million, my son would be sitting beside me. I'm sure of it. Absolutely sure of it.
They see the money. Money can be the root of all evil.
Right now, agencies are funded by how many children they have in care. And if the number of children decrease, they get less funding.
And that is the chief motive for the agencies to go out and take more children, build more facilities to care for the children and to house the social workers that are necessary to keep the operation going.
Right. Even though they may be doing an excellent job at reducing the number of kids in care, so they get dinged, they don't get the funding, and then they're less able to do that prevention work, that family reunification work.
I don't want to give anyone the impression that I don't subscribe to the cynical view that somehow agencies are sitting down and perpetuating having high volume of cases so they can have more money coming in and more workers being employed. I don't think that happens.
With the example in Windsor, is there's a very clear, I think, in my opinion, a very clear example of empire building. You know,
you can't stop if your budget is geared by the number of children that you look after.
When we've got a tripling of the budget from 1999, I believe it was, to 2004, the budget went from something like $16 million to $45 million or $42 million in our local area. You have a tripling of the budget, a huge number of new children taken into care, and then a brand new building put up. I have to ask myself, whose best interest is this agency working in?
It's absolutely a nightmare for families to have a funding formula in which the agencies have an incentive to take children away from parents. The incentive should be the reverse of that. They should get a bonus when they send a kid back to mom and dad.
Thunder Bay is benefiting big time with our kids in care. I don't know how many mortgages they're paying.
This baby snatching system became a big business only in the last couple of decades.
Well, I think the disconnect is in the history.
The residential school, well, we all know now, it's out there, you know, that this was a disastrous failure and people are still trying to recover from it.
Children were taken at ages 4, 5, and 6 from their parents, and they were institutionalized and they were cared for by caretakers, by, you know, church people, by clergy, by, you know, all of those people. And for the most part, they weren't given that love. And that's what we see right now, right? So people turning to addictions, not being able to parent and not being able to give that love back again.
I'm not a residential school survivor, but I lived with one that was, and he was an ugly, ugly man. He was very abusive, both physical, mental, emotional, you name it. I got it from him. I was sexually abused by him. You know, it's no fun picture. And where did he get that from? He got it from the boarding school.
So then you see the cycle happening and continuing, right? So then those children become parents and their children are taken from them. You know, so it's a vicious cycle.
The statistics are that there are more children in care now than there were registered in all of the residential, the whole history of the residential schools.
So the government, right, has these children and these are wards of the government. And just the same as these children were wards of the residential school system. And many of these children are in non-Aboriginal homes. So, you know, whether you have the best non-Aboriginal homes possible, you know, children still hear stereotypes and discrimination and experience racism and all of those things that teach them that they're not important for who they are as Aboriginal people.
Except the way our native people live. We don't have fancy houses where kids have individual rooms. We don't care. We grew up, there was 4 of us in a room. It didn't make any difference. The agency's got to come back to what a native community is like. Not all those big strict rules. You gotta have a bedroom, you gotta have this for yourself. Soften up those rules a little bit.
They're resilient. just have to improve what they have. That's all they need. They're not crying for mountains of money. They just need directions or support or to access for help. They're going to feel good for themselves because they help themselves. We need to listen to those people. They're not asking a lot.
They took the power away from us making a decision about this kid, about this child, and they basically I won't say kept it all to themselves, but which they had no right to.
I can't even tell you, you know, this was supposed to be his home, and they just and he was working on believing that this was his home, and they went and they circumvented and they destroyed every ounce of like stability he had created in his own mind.
It took away my dignity as a person and my parental rights as a mother.
We were working as a family. If we could just put the Delico aside, we were a happy family.
I did nothing wrong. I did nothing wrong. I never abused anybody. I never hurt my kids. I was a good mom. I did nothing wrong. And they took it all.
They took everything we had and then some.
If they had taken just a small portion of the money they spent on this family and had some help in the home, I would have saved mega thousands of dollars and I would have still had a family.
I was denied access with them. And once I did get access, it was supervised for a long time. I didn't know nothing about reviews or anything. I was told I could have a review for my house being closed. I didn't go. I didn't know what to do. I didn't take no other professional with me to help me talk. So Delico won that one because all Dolores Moulton bought all her case notes. I told you, I'm not a paper person. I never keep notes. To this day, I still don't keep notes.
I mean, we're protecting children, but if we're not protecting them within the concept of the greater community and the fact that everyone wants to work together to keep family strong, then we're just tearing the fabric apart. And it's amazing that people can't see that. You know, that Lena can't have her grandchildren because of some silly little situation that occurred. I mean, it's heartbreaking, and you see the grief of people. You know, this whole having children torn from your A family, A immediate family, B extended family, C community. Everybody suffers from that. Everybody suffers.
And what makes an adoptive parent, what kind of criteria do they have? What makes them any more experienced to look after my child than I am? Are they asked if they've taken any of these courses? Are they experienced with children with ADHD? None of us knows that.
There's a child's health file that's on file. And even though we were the adoptive parents who were supposedly going to adopt this child, we never received that health file. Never knew anything about that health file.
For one thing, the agency, when they wanted the family to come to a meeting to comply with them, they would hold Daniel's extracurricular activities hostage. They would say, unless you come to mediation with us, we're not going to allow Daniel to do this extracurricular program or that extracurricular program or anything like that. Which has, so essentially they're punishing the child because they have an issue with the foster parents. It's not cool. It's not fair.
I expected them to take my son, my beautiful, innocent little boy, to a loving, caring home. Isn't that what a foster home should be? Should be, but it's not.
Since the political will is not there to abolish the system, everyone should be looking at ways to open up the system and get as much information about it as possible.
Well, see, and I don't actually think they realize, like, because I didn't realize how much power that I had until I left it. I think the power that was given to me, I didn't abuse it, but I didn't understand how to appreciate it and still work it. The responsibility you have, like, it's insane. It's totally crazy how you're caring for these lives and their emotional development. And I think they forget that, yes, the children are the victims and the children are your clients. I think because there's just so many, you know, processes that you have to do, you forget to use your brain, use your own common sense, because you have to make sure all your T's are crossed and whatever, you got to cover your butt. It wasn't a positive team to be a part of, and then I was actually taken advantage of. My experience at North Branch, like, I'm still extremely hurt by it because I know that I was abused. They just wanted me to do whatever they told them to do and not question. So I came in with this perspective of, hey, like, how can we empower the clients to better their situations? And the supervisor of the team said point blank, we cannot empower clients. That it was impossible. They hated me because I always asked those questions. I really wanted to help people and make a difference.
What this province has in place right now to deal with that is not going to get the job done, and they're failing miserably at it. And it needs to be dismantled from the bottom all the way up. And I think the only way to do that is to bring the ombudsman in. They need oversight. We need a full public inquiry into child protection in this province.
Ontario is the only province in Canada that cannot, where the ombudsman cannot investigate problems that exist in those institutions. My question is, why?
Premier, the Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Thank you very much, and I'm pleased to talk about the independent CAS oversight, because we support that, because we already have that, Speaker. Child Welfare Services already have a number of mandated independent oversights, including family court oversight of all child protection matters before the court, the Child and Family Services Review Board, the Ombudsman, who has oversight of the Child and Family Services Review Board, the Auditor General, and the Office of the Chief Coroner and the Pediatric Death Review, which again provides independent, unbiased reports regarding...
Stop clock for a second.
Laura Broughton said in response to my question that there is oversight. And in fact, she mentioned that we've got the Child and Family Services Review Board that does this oversight. But we know recently the Supreme Court has ruled that this body does not have the power to hear Children's Aid Society's complaints that are before the courts.
When you ask somebody from the Chamber of Commerce, would you speak up about this, they say, that's not my job. If you ask somebody who works for the newspaper, they'll say, well, you know, it's a confidentiality thing. No, that's not my job. If you ask people that are particularly familiar with a case, or it's their child, or it's somebody in the community, they don't want to speak up. The people who are the social workers, they don't want to speak up. And when you take any kind of concern to the Ministry of Child and Youth Services, they don't want to speak up.
I don't know. Going to your Liberal MPP, was that going to get you? I really don't. We need to be able to go somewhere and feel that when we state our case, somebody will hear. And we need to validate the pain that people are experiencing. And we don't validate that pain by saying, we're taking care of things. We're doing, we have systems in place, because we don't. And so it would almost make you feel that somehow Laura Broughton knows that
this is the case. And she continues to insist to my questioning that there is oversight. It's almost, you want to think that she is deliberately not telling the truth. Deliberately not telling the truth. And I don't understand why she would be doing that.
So tell government, when are you going to wait for another boarding school before all these kids come of age and start having lawsuits with them? Is that what they're waiting for?
The way I would do it if I were premier is to say,
I want the ombudsman to go in. And I want him to bring back his recommendations because I want to solve the problem. That's what you could do. And until you do that, of course you're going to be afraid of having the ombudsman go into a hospital, reveal individual and or systemic problems, because then you're going to look bad. Be bold. Be a leader from time to time, for God's sake. Do something.
And that's top of mind right now because the bill was voted down last week as we're speaking in May of 2011. It was just turned down last week.
All those opposed to the motion will please rise and remain standing until recorded by the clerk.
Mr. Phillips.
Mr. Phillips.
Mr. Ruprecht.
Mr. Ruprecht.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Ms. Best.
Ms. Best.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Ms. Broughton.
Ms. Broughton.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Arthur.
Mr. Arthur.
Mr. Barardinetti.
Mr. Barardinetti.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Ramal.
Mr. Ramal.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Kular.
Mr. Kular.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Jassic.
Ms. Jassic.
Ms. Pendergast.
Ms. Pendergast.
The Liberals voted against it, and the Conservatives and NDP voted for it. It was an NDP private members' bill put forward.
The ayes are 10, the nays are 22.
The ayes being 10, the nays being 22, I declare the motion lost. All matters relating to private members' public business having been completed, we now call orders of the day. Minister without portfolio.
Speaker, I move adjournment of the House.
Monday, 10:30 a.m.
Get out and vote. Do your job. Your silence is your consent. And in my book, then we're just as guilty as the perpetrators. If we say nothing, then we can't complain about it.
You're going to fall hard one of these days. You know, karma, what you do to others is going to come back to them. I really strongly believe that. Our kids are going to be free soon.